So let me start by introducing our panelists. We have Lauren Ingram. Lauren is the founder of Women in Web3, a community that helps women get into the Web3 space. So she has over a decade of experience in marketing agencies and tech companies, including Meta. She is responsible for Meta's program for female entrepreneurs, hashtag She Means Business. She is a marketing consultant to the Web3 space and also hosts the Women in Web3 podcast. So very important subject. Only 5% of women are in the Web3 space, I believe. I'm going to ask you more on that later. Our next speaker is Adam Simmons. Adam is the Chief Strategy Officer of RDXWorks and a co-developer of Radix Protocol. Fantastic. Two nice, interesting hats. He is a serial entrepreneur. Prior to joining RDX, he built an online video platform that scaled to 35 million monthly active users. Phenomenal. And co-founded crypto project Veracity, where he grew VRA token community to over 250K people. Wow, impressive. Good job, Adam. And our third speaker is, our third panelist is Valentin Winsenden. Am I saying that right? So Valentin leads the product strategy at Copper. Before joining Copper, he spent 4 years at checkout.com, and he's worn multiple hats as well. So successfully building the company's risk product, and creating and scaling the data function as VP of Business Intelligence. That's hat number one. And leading its strategy and go-to-market as VP of strategy, hat number two. Valentin has over a decade of B2B experience in the fintech space. You have some really good speakers here. I'm going to kick off the conversation with Adam. Why is Web3 important and why should we care?
So, really good question. The easiest way I can describe it is, if the internet is the global data layer for the world, then I think Web3 has the opportunity to be the global asset layer for the world. And the reason that matters is, as we're seeing already with things like, topically, the FTX collapse and the issues around there, ownership of our own assets is very important, but more importantly, how we utilize them on a global layer. And the reason why I think it matters to each and every one of us is really quite simple. And that's the, in my opinion, the global financial system primarily exists to efficiently allocate capital based on opportunity, factoring in risk. And a global asset layer allows that to be far more viable in far many new ways. And this doesn't mean that Web3 is going to make global finance fair. It just means it'll make it more of an opportunity for each and every one of us to participate in the way we want to, and create more opportunity and competition within that market.
I like the idea, it's okay, I'll just speak loud, it's probably easier. I do like the idea of a global asset layer, and we are certainly going to explore that further. Talking about a global asset layer, Lauren, Web3 hasn't become as mainstream as you all expected 5 years ago, right? Why is that? What do you think is the reason behind that?
I think there's a couple of main reasons. I think one of them is the user experience. I think a lot of people are sort of instantly turned off thinking like, oh, I'm not technical, I'm sort of not qualified to do this. Like, you know, if they're signing a transaction with a crypto wallet, they're like, oh, you know, I'm either signing my life away or I'm, yeah, basically not qualified to do this somehow. So it's partly that, if that can be, feel sort of more slick and natural. But I think it's also about people understanding the benefit. I think they are starting to, like, sort of man or woman on the street is starting to understand some of the concepts of Web3 about it, you know, how it's the sort of third major iteration of the internet. But they don't necessarily see the benefit in their own life. And I think actually even words like assets, there'll be plenty of people that think, oh, I don't even have any assets, that I've got nothing to me in that way. And so it's kind of, yeah, making it make sense to the individual and then how they can then easily participate. I think that's what's missing. And it almost needs some like Web2, I don't know, jazz hands to make it more appealing in that way to the wider public.
It's interesting you say that, because I tried to explain it to some of my non-technical friends and I struggle because the jargon that we have, non-fungible token, right? Who knows what a fungible token is to begin with, right? So what's a non-fungible
token? What the fuck is fungible?
Exactly. Exactly right. So yeah, it's interesting that you say that the user experience is something that we need to narrow down on. Valentin, I have an interesting question for you. It's the elephant in the room. We have to discuss this, right? So with the FTX crash, what do you think, what are the repercussions of that? What do you predict for this industry?
That's the easy one. I think we're going to see several movements. We're going to see first a big change in regulation, because obviously we, you know, as a community, we could have done better in working on this kind of big liability for the overall ecosystem. I think the other thing is that indeed Web3 is probably in the long run, in the short term, people are probably a bit more scared, you know, in any kind of venture, be it centralized or decentralized, but obviously because as Lauren was saying, the UI, the UX is much more painful, so people might be more scared even in using Web3 as using a more centralized function. But the fact that trust was probably a bit lost in terms of the way that the exchanges and the centralized actors were acting in preserving capital in this environment might push people to use Web3, everything else being equal otherwise. I think that's the key thing.
So your opinion is that it's going to have a positive impact going forward?
Yeah, I think generally speaking, this is the kind of thing that happened in TradFi before. That looks a lot like Lehman in 2008, that looks a lot like the kind of bubbles that explode. You always have, before the regulation really kicks in, you always have some bad actors that, you know, don't shine a good light over the rest of the industry. So once those bubbles explode, that allows the whole ecosystem to build again from scratch. And that, I think, is what's going to happen moving forward. So if you have the right positioning starting from now, you're going to be able to be one of the good actors moving forward, which is the goal of everyone here, I guess.
That probably also draws more people's attention to it. So I feel like lots of people I know, family and friends in the last week are sort of starting to ask me about this stuff, and I've sort of never cared about crypto until this week, even with my Women of Web3 stuff, and they're like, what's Women of Web? Just in the last week, they're like, what is this stuff? And I think maybe it's partly because they're seeing the scale of the money involved, that they're kind of like, is this something I ought to be paying attention to? I think you're probably right, that ultimately will probably end up leading to a big uptake.
Does anyone have a counterpoint to that?
I spoke to my family today, and they're like, you gotta leave this industry. And it's like, that's actually been the most reliable bottom signal for me, because basically that's, when people hear about crypto, you hear about this, it's either a scam or it's the greatest thing on planet Earth, right? It's up and down. So, and we're seeing the flip side of it now, right? So.
Actually, that leads me to my next question. 2020 has seen a lot of implosions. We had Terra Luna, we had, what is it? I have some of the names here, Celsius, and now FTX. Obviously, trust must have eroded in the market, especially when it comes to large-scale institutional investors. So two questions on that. First of all, I said, have you seen a big impact? Have you seen the tides changing from your analysis? But more importantly to everyone else, what do we do as an industry to regain that trust?
Yeah, to start off with from the data side, obviously this cycle over 2020 to 2022, tremendous influx of institutional investors and capital into the space. I think you've seen several headlines, but also people we haven't heard about who have entered the space in size. And usually these players have, you know, pretty long cycles to actually get gain the confidence to enter. So they're here for the long haul. They're not gonna, you know, flee at the first sign of trouble. So that's good. You know, we have a base of capital. It's like $1 trillion asset. So it's gonna stay for a while. And then it remains to be seen how can we grow this further. It's still a ways to go before other asset classes, right, to catch up to things like gold or other asset classes.
How do you build back that trust? How do you gain it back? Any opinion?
So, I think generally speaking, institutional, not even investors, but any kind of institutional actors have a huge appetite for safety, much more than individuals. I think that anyone in this room probably has a much higher risk profile and risk appetite that, you know, the average person in the street. But as soon as you go, you grow an institution, and if you go into the large banks, the large institutions of the world, those institutions are extremely risk averse, which is very fortunate because otherwise we would all be in big trouble. But because so far most of the trust and most of the concentration of power was in the hands of the exchanges, you had this kind of power balance of basically all of that centralization landing in just those few hands. And those exchanges, we've seen, not all of them fully, but there was at least one bad apple. And that, once we have discovered that as an ecosystem, as an industry, we need to make sure that this overall balance of power is more shared across all of the actors. That's if you're an institutional custodian like we're at Copper, obviously you're powering this kind of safety mechanism for all of the ecosystem. But any kind of actor, any kind of institutional player is going to play a bigger part, as the exchanges will play a slightly smaller part of holding that trust and holding that control for the whole ecosystem. So I think we all have a part to share in making sure that we build that trust.
Cool. I think the other thing about institutions coming into the space, especially in a DeFi environment, is many can't enter the space due to their investment thesis, due to their counsel, however they actually deploy capital, is they need to know the counterparties they're interacting with, they need to know what they're engaging. I've had many, many conversations with people when you're like, oh, are you doing an equity round rather than tokens, because we are just not allowed to buy tokens. Going into something like Uniswap or any other DEXs or things like that is just a no-goer. And that's why we're starting to see in the space, obviously the big ones, people like, are they doing tests of how do we get institutional capital to come in an effective way? And I think it's going to take time. And as a space, I think the challenge off the back of something like FTX is very much looking at how do we move the dialogue in a way that's constructive. And the analogy I give to regulation is somewhat stretched, but is very similar in my mind to things like social media platforms. Because there's obviously a lot of debate about those in the last couple of years and about how they're influencing public opinion and things like that. And there was obviously the big debate about whether they are publishers or platforms.
Right.
Yeah. And the end state of that, or where we currently are in that, is that it seems like neither really apply to what they are. And I think this is something that the regulators around the world are going to have to start coming to, is that actually DeFi and Web3, you can't just have a knee-jerk reaction to things like FTX and go, well, we'll apply exactly the same way we did before. Because you just technically can't. Like, you can't go and regulate Uniswap in the same way as you would an exchange. And that creates a lot of challenges, which we need to be very conscious about as an industry to help inform and guide how we can actually do that in a meaningful way. And also there's the other major thing that many of the entities in Web3 are multi-jurisdictional, and the people who access them are global. So what applies in one jurisdiction may not apply in another, or vice versa, and that creates whole new challenges for an open and permissionless network.
This is true, yeah. How do we feel about governments getting involved in terms of, I don't know, being part of the blockchain or hosting some of the blockchain? Or in fact, I mean, regulation we've spoken about, but what about other aspects of the government you think could help?
I think governments generally need to set the tone, but as we've seen, a lot of the regulation has been coming from innovation. And if you really build the right innovation for trust, for safety, you are setting the standards for institutional safety, institutional custody, institutional execution, institutional trading, and you typically have that conversation with governments by leading them to understand what can be done, understand how things should be done, and bringing them to the right situation. And that's something that exists in all kind of industry, whether it's crypto, payments, any kind of innovation usually comes first, and governments regulate second. So it's really important for us, and we've, if you listen to a bit of the history of what happened with FTX, one part of the story was that SBF was deeply lobbying against probably the right side of the regulation, lobbying against Web3 for very selfish reasons, but that's the important thing to do as any good actor in the industry, is to promote that kind of good regulation to make sure that you work with the important governments, be that the US, Germany, the UK, Switzerland, all the ones that are really setting the standard globally, so that we end up with the right level of regulation for the consumer and for good actors, and not to protect some personal interests.
So Coinbase is a public limited company, right, or a publicly listed company, right? Does that make a difference, you feel, for the business in terms of the trust, or how does it help or not help Coinbase?
Yeah, huge difference. I mean, for one, it's publicly listed in the United States. It's audited by big four audited companies. You can see all the financials. Customer assets are required by law to be held 1-to-1. You can't be lending them out without permission. So, all huge positives in this kind of environment. And it's actually a case that Coinbase has been making to the U.S. government now, which is like the situation like FTX ended up because regulation wasn't clear enough in the States that it drove an entity like FTX International offshore to do all these kinds of operations. Customers weren't as protected.
I think that point on clarity is really important as well, is that we engage extensively and have done for quite a while at Radix with various regulators, legal opinions, and quite often it's reading tea leaves, which is challenging, is they're not wanting to make a commitment on it because they don't understand the space, and the rate it's evolving is quicker than they can understand it. And so then you're quite often left in this position where you're trying to be a good actor and account for these things and be a responsible participant in market, and what you're getting back is, we'll wait and see. It's like, we can't wait and see forever. We've got to make some even technical design decisions on which way this is going to be implemented. And I think any clarity would be useful, because a wise thing that one of our legal team once said is the rules of a regulator grind slowly but finally. and that is a big concern, because you don't want to have something 3-5 years down the line, which was done in good intention, become a problem because it was unclear at the time.
That's actually a good point, because I have a bit of a central position to take here. So obviously in the UK you have the central banking digital currency, right? What do you guys see the role of that currency is going to be in this ecosystem? You can take the negative position as well.
So if you look at the history of private money, if you look at that, it existed in the US a good few decades ago, where banks could emit their own money, and you didn't have an actual central control. And those banks were, this money emitted by the different local banks was accepted only in regional spaces, and was heavily discounted as soon as you started going away from those banks. Nowadays, because of the centralization that we have, and the speed of communication across the globe, that's much easier to have something that is centralized, like USDC, USDT, and all of that. The issue with that is that you still need to have a very, very, very strong regulation to make sure that those currencies are properly backed and are actual money and not an investment vehicle that is not regulated, because otherwise you very quickly go into short-term deposits which are invested, and then you create a risk, and you're like in the 80s, you end up with a money market crisis which needs to be bailed out. And we're still paying out. The US and the Europe is still paying out for that, bailing out 40 years later. So I think that the central bank cryptocurrencies are trying to compete with this. And the question is whether they will compete, regulate the other stable coins out of existence, or they will cohabitate, or they will just, they need a nice proof of concept, but ultimately the best technological solution will win, and they will just make sure that they regulate really, really properly that kind of use case. Ultimately, the use case is largely FX transactions, ease of payment, bridge between the different assets and chains and everything that you want. So if you have a technology that works, you don't necessarily need something that is built by the government. You can have something that is regulated and controlled by the government, but doesn't seem to replace the existing situation that works really well.
I guess the original vision of something like Bitcoin was to have a currency that's not linked to monetary policy or fiscal policy, right? However, monetary policy, in my opinion, this is a game, right? Monetary policy and fiscal policy might be good for for a currency that becomes wide scale? What is your opinion?
It's a very tough question. I'd say one of the big things, so at Consensus this year, there was many, many panels about central bank digital currencies with many former chairmen and board members of Futures and Commodities Commission, etc., with different views. And I think at this stage, the big feeling from many of them was, if there is a central bank digital currency, is what is the ethos behind it? What is it trying to achieve? And a big concern was the US not having one was that the digital yen will become a standard. And obviously associated with the digital yen is a lot of the programmable money type of things of, are there restrictions on where you can spend it, how you can use it, who can access it? And if that becomes an adopted standard, that maybe isn't what many people in the world would be comfortable with. And the other approach is going, well, what if you had a CBDC that was designed to behave very intrinsically like physical cash? No restrictions on it, but it was backed by a government. And obviously that does give some assurances. And it's a tough one to balance, and I think it'll be a big emerging space.
If I can follow up on that one. I think the importance is, as you exactly said, balance. And there is a huge difference between wanting some form of privacy and some form of decentralization, which is generally good, as long as you don't go into the other perverse effect of just allowing anyone to do anything they want and having bad actors, you know, drug and terrorism and all of that being financed. On the other hand, if you end up in a situation with programmable money, then you give an incommensurate power to just a few individuals, which is also, as a society, something that I think we should absolutely fight against, because that's extremely dangerous. So I think the right thing is to be somewhere in the balance, and this is just adding some friction to the system, because you should be able to regulate, you should be able to track money. The problem is with programmable, you don't have any friction. So as a state, you can literally control everything in with just the click of a button, in theory, which is not something that you want. Obviously, you should be able to pursue any kind of terrorism, any kind of, but you need to have a minimum cost for the regulator, for the executive power, for the government to go after those bad actors, because otherwise you can go just after anyone, and it's very easy to define who is a bad actor, who is that in all of our history as mankind. So
yeah, kind of adding to that, actually, it's a very relevant one in terms of transparency. FTX FTT scenario was a key case. Like, say, for, people could see what was being done with the FTT on chain. It was one of the first cases where it's the wisdom of the Twitter on-chain analysts who were seeing what was happening with FTT live, seeing the flows, how it was being laundered, which parties were using it, etc. Which we can't tell right now with fiat currencies, right? Like, 50 bips or 70 bips, we don't know. Some knob turns and some people make the decision. So if we can have a little bit more transparency from that side of things, it's still a net positive.
You also have the inverse of that, though, of too much transparency. So one of the big things on chain is, if I were to send any of you some money with TradFi, I would need your bank account details or Venmo or whatever, and you would get the money into your account. You wouldn't understand everything about my net worth and my assets that I hold. Whereas in Web3 today, if I was to send you some USDC, unless I'm very, very complex in how I've structured my accounts, a simple chain analytics could tell you everything about my financial situation on chain. That's probably not desirable either. And so this is where, again, regulators have got a really tough challenge, because mixes and things to anonymize transactions between peers is necessary. It's something which most free and open societies would want, but that in turn causes challenges for regulators on how they actually then pursue bad actors in that case. And I think this is, again, a massively emerging area which is going to cause many headaches for many regulators.
I just wanted to add just a sort of random anecdote, really, which is I met someone a couple of weeks ago, I think maybe at NFT London, and he said that his co-founder owned 70-something Bored Ape Yacht Club NFTs. And I was like, no way. But then you can just go and look it up. So I looked on OpenSea, which is kind of the biggest platform for trading NFTs, went and found his profile. And yes, he does own 74 Bored Ape Yacht Club NFTs and 14 Mutant Apes, which is the kind of slightly cheaper version. So at a minimum, like, I could have actually gone in and looked at, probably at a minimum of about $9 million worth of NFTs. And you could see which dates he'd moved them, when he bought them, for what value, although you'd also have to know what the value of Ether on that date was, but you could literally just go and look that up, you know, just go and all this information is sort of publicly available. And so you're right, there was, from a sort of almost like a sort of gossip standpoint, I was like, this is fascinating, but also, yeah, there'll be instances where people kind of slightly want to flaunt that, and others when they definitely wouldn't.
Cool. Switching gears to something that's a bit near and dear to my heart. The intersection of cloud and Web3. I've got to ask this question. So what are cloud providers like AWS doing right? And what should we be doing in the future, 2023? So most of you all are customers of AWS. So you probably have an opinion one way or another. Who wants to go first?
I'll go first. So I think, obviously, cloud server power is something which is necessary for the space. And one of the big things that, ever since I got involved professionally within Web3 and crypto, is not everything necessarily needs to be on chain. There's things that don't need to be crunched elsewhere. The challenge on the flip side is to avoid centralization through proxies. So one of the things that we see often in the Radix community, we're a proof of stake network, is people asking the validators who run on our network, where are you hosted? Where is your validator running? What redundancies do you have? Is there too much geographical centralization? Is there efficient redundancies in place? And this is a tough thing to balance. And then the final piece is also making sure that that's not through computing power that you start seeing problems. So one of the big things, obviously, if you look at, say, Solana's validator infrastructure, you need obscene amounts of computing power. And that then becomes a problem for other participants entering the space. You start getting centralization of that, and that becomes a point of weakness in the system. So this is exactly something that we saw talking about a non-compliant mixer, but Tornado Cash, which was a way you could obscure your funds and the recipients of those. That was, many transactions were blocked on Ethereum because the node operators were targeted and told not to process them. And so this is a really interesting thing and how we balance that.
Yeah, and in terms of, you know, because obviously you need to build things, right? When you can't just use them. So when you want to build anything, the ability of experimenting, the ability of deploying things really fast, the ability of spinning up nodes, running them in different environments, making sure that you can deploy them in customer environments if you're building things for other people as well. This is something that is usually powered by AWS, because in terms of standard, this is something that is used across all different institutions, and especially institution trust AWS. So you know, you can build something that is trustless, but at some point you still need to have the hardware underneath, and that hardware needs to be trusted, needs to be secure. You need to have all of the different certifications that are understood and valued across different geographies and across different actors. So basically, that's really where you can shake hand at the lowest level and agree on a similar type of infrastructure.
Makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, to add to that, we were just talking with Luke about this earlier, which is like, it's kind of a different paradigm with on-chain applications, with dApps, where, you know, with a normal web app, you need a backend, right? Like EC2 instance or whatever. With a dApp, you don't, the backend is a blockchain, right? Like, and it contains the state, and the real infrastructural need is a good data transfer layer and data availability layer, where you can actually consume data from the blockchain in a parsed way to make sense for your app, do your business logic, and then transfer that data, that state back on chain in a performant way. And you know, when building dApps, that's the biggest thing. There's some infra providers now, but it's a big opportunity for cloud providers, I think, you know, for any dApp builder to have a performant, you know, the data layer interfacing between the blockchain.
Makes sense, yeah, thank you for that, thanks a lot. Lauren, you have your finger on the pulse with your podcast. The question is, what is the next big thing in Web3?
the $1 million question. I don't know if I could safely say, especially after this last week. Well, yeah, this is like, I was like watching a soap opera. Like, don't know where it's going. I suppose what am I most excited about? I don't think there's actually any one specific area that I'm kind of all in on. I suppose the part that I enjoy about Web3, almost like when almost kind of watching from the sidelines, whether it's kind of interviewing people on the Women of Web3 podcast, or generally, is seeing that amount of innovation is that people are taking these kind of Web3 principles around decentralization and giving people, like giving humans ownership of their assets, their own data, and then applying that to create new businesses and sort of scale them and fund them very quickly. That's what really excites me, is just like seeing the number of new ideas. It literally every single day, anytime I open my like LinkedIn or Twitter, I'm like, oh, that's pretty cool. I never heard of that. Or I feel like I saw the same thing 10 years ago when I was like living in Berlin and in a bunch of like Web2 startups. They're just surrounded by quite inspiring people in terms of that level of innovation. So slightly sidetracked. It's a nothing answer of like I don't like a sort of hedging my bets answer, but genuinely that's what I find exciting, is the like sheer amount of innovation.
Obviously, Radix protocol is going to be the next.
Yes, officially yes.
All right, I'm going to ask the audience for some questions. I'm going to open it up to the audience. If you have any questions for our panelists,
I can ask. I mean, I'm just interested about your comment that you mentioned, like, I mean, the cloud providers can do the state management, right? I mean, you pull the data, you do whatever you need to do, and then you push the state back. So you're talking about some inherently the characteristics, right? I mean, that what was it you're trying to say there? Is it the latency that you're worried about, the performance, the throughput? Can you translate that a little bit more so that, I mean, it will be good for me to understand?
Sure. So I'll give you an example. So the blockchain has thing, raw blockchain data, right? Blocks, transactions, things of that nature. When you're building an app on chain, you're trying to represent some sort of business logic or state. Sometimes you need to parse the data in the transaction. Say I'm sending an NFT and then listing it on a marketplace like OpenSea. It's coded in a smart contract, right? And in an ideal way, in an ideal world, I want to get the state of all the listed NFTs. I want to get all of their bids and asks and floor prices and things of that nature, which needs to be parsed from the raw data that's on chain. If I can just query an API to get that data, right now there's some tools in there out there. There's things like the Graph and Dune Analytics and other data providers. But if I can just query an AWS, some sort of service to just get that data parsed, do my logic with it, and then transfer that state back, that's all that's needed. That's the only backend that I need. I don't actually need to maintain the state myself. Otherwise, as an app provider, oftentimes most apps now are asked to create their own state, parse state that's relevant to their app's business logic. So if you can have like generalized parse layers of data that's available to be queried by app developers, that's huge.
Thank you.
So the premise of a lot of what was said today and a lot of what's been said in the press over the past couple of weeks is that cryptocurrency should be a store of value or a medium of exchange. Is that just a huge distraction from all of the innovation that Web3 can unlock? Web3 is not about asset prices, right? We're creating a Web3 game, and I couldn't care less what the crypto prices were. I care about the ownership and the social experiences and everything else that unlocks. So is there a future where we just stop talking about the price of Ethereum and we just focus on Web3 technology and the experiences it creates?
I suppose that's the way I feel about it, is kind of exactly that. I think at the moment people, as you say, sort of focus too much on the, maybe it's like the floor price of an NFT or the value of one particular cryptocurrency or what's happening with FTX. And we are actually talking about like a major next stage of the internet that will inevitably become as the sort of dominant set of technologies over the next 5 to 10 years. And so I think some of these sort of big, like the sort of crypto turmoil at the moment, I think you're right, is creating a lot of fearfulness and distraction that will put people off the idea of what Web 3.0 could offer the sort of wider public and what sort of society. I think it will initially put them off. But as I say, it might also make them pay attention to like, oh, was I supposed to care about crypto? Was I supposed to care about this sort of Web3 stuff, NFTs, whatever? And so I feel like there's almost like an opportunity now to sort of go in and like rescue that messaging. So sort of thinking as a marketer, I'm like, this is actually quite a good moment to go and course correct. Because you're right, like business, Web3 business, or even like brands entering Web3 is quite divorced from the price of crypto. And sort of should stay that way. Like, brands shouldn't be put off by what's happening at FTX, for example.
Yeah, and if you compare with another recent innovation, email, and then to start talking about websites and this kind of, you know, because ultimately the true value relied in the API and everything that was built on top of it. So I think it takes a lot of time. And usually you start by one specific innovation, which is the bar of your tea, and then you add everything on top. And I think it's quite well known that it's, you know, people don't really change mindset, apart from maybe a very limited number of people who really, really make that effort. The only thing that happens is that actually all generations die, and you end up with a new generation that was native and that truly understands the new thing. So I think that we will need, because that's such an innovation, you can build technology extremely fast, but people don't change that fast. And ultimately, you just need to have people replacing the old guard.
Wait, so everyone needs to die first, and then we can get to Web 3.0. Cool.
Positive. Very positive.
Or you can teach all of them much faster.
So I agree mostly there, but I think one thing that, to answer your question, will we all forget about the price of tokens? No is the simple answer to that. And the reason I say no is not because of speculative value. It's because of ultimately all networks are secured by some form of a proof of stake, proof of work, which is directly tied to the value of that asset. And so if those assets don't have value, you don't have security of that network. And so there is some degree there that you've got protection against civil protection deferred from that. And if you remove that, then why would you trust that network for transferring assets? And then there comes to a really good question of where things like AWS come in, and where I say not everything should be on chain. And the reason I say that is because there is a much higher economic bar to put information on chain. And you get a much higher degree of trust and certainty by doing so, but not everything warrants that. So not only back-end logic, but even like your front-end UI, why would you put that on chain? It's gonna cost you way more than deploying it on AWS or something to distribute, and serves no economic benefit in doing so. And so I think this is where there needs to be a conscious choice of what are you putting on chain and what economic benefit and security benefit do you get from doing that, and the security of that network is tied to the value of the assets.
I guess the follow-up there is, does there need to be a public good chain that exists globally or nationally or something, where those incentives don't play such a big role?
I can repeat that question. The question was, does there need to be a public chain where the incentives where an entity like a government or a group of governments support the chain, so that we don't have to worry about the intrinsic value spent on the chain to keep it running?
I think as soon as you remove the problem of cost, you remove the problem of efficiency, and you remove the need for innovation. And I think that costs are a good thing. If you're building something without cost, you don't know if you're actually building something that does create value. So I think we should keep a notion of cost, and that happens, you know, even internally inside a company, right? If you're building a project, you want to know what your costs are, because if you're just building something without knowing that, you have no idea whether you're actually creating economic value for the society or not.
And yeah, you're right. You don't have the incentive to push the boundary. Right. Go ahead.
And what about currencies for communities? You don't need to have a value of the currency for community to use it. You just have a standard basket value, and then the implementation is coming in.
Yeah, but I think that you still need to have...
Here it is already, the Web3 technologies for the actual currencies or for the communities, without thinking of the price of the Ethereum, because they are not going to the main chain. They are going in, like you said exactly, like there is no need to have on the main chain everything. So Web3 in reality can be like chain of chains, like local communities. Sorry, my voice is good.
So it's a really good point. I think the challenge with something like that is if you have chains of chains, so my opinion, the problem with everything like layer twos or sharding of networks,
yeah,
typically
layer
is
two, obviously, yes.
The problem there is you lose interoperability between those chains, and that is one of the superpowers of
Web3. And bridges?
Bridges, you still lose interoperability. So using a economic example of this is arbitrage. One of the superpowers of Web3 is you can buy and sell in a single transaction, essentially with zero risk, or not do it if it doesn't, and that creates a more efficient market. As soon as you create any time, currently on Ethereum today and other non-sharded networks, there is no time, it's zero, it's 100% efficient. As soon as you add any kind of bridge or step or roll up or something like that, you have a time period, which then exposes you to counterparty risk and you create a less efficient market. You also have the problem of you have to trust those other networks. So it's great for a single local community, definitely. But if that local community wants to trade with another, they have to trust each other's networks. And that itself creates a problem, and I think is why Web3 is so appealing for most people, is you have a unified truth of what is value and where is it being transacted, and you don't have to trust a counterparty.
You just blew my mind. I learned a lot in the last minute.
So I only know about this is because this is one of the secret sources of Radix, is our consensus system solves scalability and parallelization without breaking atomic composability. And so atomic composability, the reason you haven't heard about it really very much is because ETH today has it. Any single chain solution has it, because every single dApp is on the same chain. Every single asset is on the same chain. They can instantly move between each other in a single transaction, and specifically be composed together at any number of levels. So you could have a single transaction and the dApp pulls multiple other dApps behind the scenes to create this incredibly complex transaction to give a single output to the user. Now, in all best guesses, you can sit there and be like, okay, well, we're gonna make a DeFi chain and only DEXs live on that DeFi chain. Well, the problem with that is, what about if you've got a lending application on a different chain that needs to be able to liquidate a collateralized debt position on the DEX? And in that time that happens, you see someone who's monitoring it off-chain, sees that sell coming through, and then they go and move the market to extract value from that position. You then get a less efficient market. The money market can't liquidate its position as efficiently, which means less people provide collateral, which means you have less liquidity in the global financial system.
It's a good answer.
That's about faster finality. Kind of like instant finality and, you know,
That is another problem with bridges, is you get hacks and any kind of interoperability between chains, you have those additional risk factors. But finality isn't actually the only answer, because finality is when the transaction is committed. So obviously fast finality is certainly good, you always want to have that. But it's different to atomic composability. So the atomic composability is that the transaction either happened or it didn't. So you can have a very, very fast finality on, say, a bridge or between L2s or something like that, where you buy on a DEX on one chain, half a second later you can go and sell on that other DEX. The problem is that's half a second. Today on Ethereum, and when you maintain atomic composability, that's zero. If the parameters of your transaction are met, so again on Ethereum you'd have to trust that has some kind of slippage function, but you can easily build that into the network if you wanted to. But at that point you can sit there and be like, well, if I am not going to make profit on that trade doesn't happen. You have zero counterparty risk that the market moves against you. And that is phenomenal for any asset, regardless of what it is. And it's ways you won't even appreciate that now. And it's where things like NFTs aren't just JPEGs. They are an asset of value. In-game assets are an asset of value that people earn. And what Web3 unlocks is the ability to compose that together in ways you'd never think of before. You can use it as collateral in a loan. You could use it as a position of trade or barter in ways you couldn't actually imagine, because behind the scenes, I could be swapping my in-game sword for your board 8, for example, of a similar value hypothetically. But behind the scenes, you can have an intermediary of USDC. There is a market for it. It all instantly composes across. You swap the sword for USDC to back to go and buy that other asset, and it's all done automatically. And as soon as you break that, you lose one of the superpowers of Web3.
Smart contracts running on. To make that happen, where would the smart contracts you think would be the most effective running on?
Ideally, you have it all running on exactly the same chain, because as soon as you start fragmenting that onto side chains, L2s, other L1s, or anything like that, then you lose some of that interoperability.
But then, how do you scale if you on one chain? That's just on Ethereum. Do you say no libraries at all?
I know how Radix does it, but I won't need to double that time. I'd happily answer it afterwards.
it goes back to state storage techniques to begin with, right? Like ACID and so on and so forth, which you know from databases. It's exactly the same philosophy in the web chain. The more atomic it is, the more efficient it is, and the more trustable it becomes. Any other questions? Yeah, go on. Do you want the mic?
So before I give my question, I'm going to give some background. So in my case, I am a lead engineer for a small crypto startup, and we build stable coins, which right now have a bit of a bad rep. But my question to you guys is what you think about... So for example, right now we have multiple processes where a user can swap, they can stake, they can bond. But as you may know, with the ERC-20, you have to allow the smart contract to transfer the funds. You cannot force a user transfer, you have to first let the contract give permission for a user's account, and then you have to make that transfer. So in many cases, when on the front end, the user has to click twice to actually do a trade or a transfer. And not only does it take time, it can take up to 30 seconds, maybe a minute, to just do the approval, and then they have to do another transaction to let us do the transfer of their tokens, their USDC or USDT. And sometimes it costs a lot of money depending on the traffic on the network. So depending on how complex the contract is, if they're using Uniswap and doing all these multiple subsequent operations, it can cost tens of dollars. So my question to you guys, what do you think about the number? How do you think the time to interact with smart contracts from a user perspective and the cost of doing it prevents us from mass user adoption?
When you know the freeways full. I think pricing rationality there is none. And that's something that AWS can provide, is transparent, kind of fixed, scalable models to help a business grow effectively. Whereas right now it's finger in the air if you're deploying on Ethereum.
Absolutely.
Well, some of these like big Eric and I were just looking at some of these chains where it's like these roll-up solutions where you can actually have you can give approval to a certain set of tokens. And just play around with those tokens. Do your trades, do your collateral, grow, etc. You don't have to keep clicking every transaction. And that's kind of the evolving model we've seen with app developers where you just interact on a roll-up and those funds are there approved to be able to transact it, to be able to be moved around on that roll-up, rather than, because right now Ethereum, as it is right now, it's very bare bones, very like base case, even the applications, even the wallet software like MetaMask. It's crazy that we're still using MetaMask, by the way, like a browser extension. Kind of crazy, right? Web3 is using MetaMask as the dominant wallet, which is crazy. I'm sure even developers here can build a better wallet than MetaMask. But we trust it because there's millions of users using it, et cetera. It's like battle-tested Lindy effect, et cetera. But still, it's something to consider.
So to answer your question, all the points you raise are super on the money. It's the problem today. One of the big things we made an early decision on at Radix was to build a full stack, and it's for that exact reason, because your fee and scalability issue is fundamentally tied to consensus. If you don't have a good consensus mechanism, doesn't matter how good the rest of the stack is, you're not going to be able to scale efficiently, and you're going to hit those bottlenecks of either finality or gas prices, etc. You then hit on the fact that you're interacting with the RC20 smart contracts and the approval and things like that. Well, that's a developer experience problem. Like, as a developer, how much of your time are you thinking orchestrating these really complex systems to avoid getting hacked, to avoid getting loss of user funds and anything like that? That's a bad experience for you, and I relate it to basically trying to build a video game before games engines existed. You can do it, but you're gonna spend a lot of your time doing really low level stuff that you don't need to do. And that's about the execution environment. And something we built at Radix was to solve that exact problem, and we did it by building assets as a native function as a language, which sounds so simple, but is such a massive game changer for what you can do there. And then you also touched on user experience and your point about MetaMask, could it be a better wallet? Maybe, but a lot of the problems in MetaMask is what they're interacting with at the execution level and also at the consensus layer. There are limitations to what they can do. So at Radix, another thing we looked at was, actually, if we want our friends, our family, our colleagues to actually engage with this, you can't sit there and say, hey, approve this app that you've never heard of to spend your USDC. How many people in this room know that most of the time when you click that button of approve, you're approving that smart contract to engage with any amount of your currency at any point?
Yeah.
Very, very few. It's terrifying. Not to mention the fact that when you actually hit trade, do you know what that transaction hash means? Or are you just trusting the dApp's web UI that it's going to do what it says it does? Well, that's another big spend approval hacks are a massive area that you're exposed. And you can't solve that problem at the user experience layer without having the rest of the stack. So, for example, in Radix, one of the big things we do at the user experience level is something we call the transaction manifest, which actually shows in real terms where are your assets, which the wallet understands because they're native to the execution environment, where are they moving, what are they interacting with, and what are you getting back. You can also set guardrails for those interactions at the network layer, not at the dApp layer, which means the developer, you don't have to worry about slippage and building that into your UI, you just, the user can do it. But then when you hit approve, you can be like, well, I'm gonna send 10 token A in, and I'm expecting to get 8 token B back. Set a guardrail, or if it's only gonna be 7, cancel the transaction. It just doesn't get processed, the network kicks it out, not the dApp. And so suddenly, but all of these things can't be done unless you have all of those layers, and you can't build patches on top of it without sacrificing things in other places.
Do you fix all of those issues if you just get rid of decentralization? Is decentralization
a problem? I mean, yes, but you also create other problems.
Back to Web 2 then.
You just have a ledger, and it's maintained by somebody that we all trust, just like my bank account.
Who do you trust?
I still trust. I trust HSBC and NatWest, and nothing you guys say is going to determine.
Come to the dark side.
Yeah, that's a valid point. But definitely a conversation to be had over a lot of beers. But I'm going to end with one question. I'm just going to ask one blue square question, right? So traditionally, assets and property are tangible, transactable things, right? This is how it has been. In the Web3 world, assets can be completely esoteric, and transactions can be fairly complex. Right? So the question to you all is, what sort of use cases do you see emerging that are so far out there, but make sense?
You want just one?
Then?
That's the problem. On your point, the exciting thing about Web3 for me, and there was an interview, I can't remember exactly who it was, but it was in the early days of the internet. Let's say it was Bill Gates, for example, was on Late Night Talk. And people asked him, the host asked him, why would I want the internet? And he was like, well, imagine being able to read your paper anywhere you wanted to. And the host was like, oh, I've got my newspaper in my bag. I carry it around with me. I can read it anywhere. He's like, oh, that's not the point. Imagine being able to talk to anyone, anywhere, at any point. And he was like, I've got my mobile phone. I can do that. Why would I want the internet? I was like, look, you're not getting it. It's not about one feature. It's not about one thing that Web3 can do different. It can do 1,000 different things slightly better. And that's exactly how I look at TradFi. TradFi is not broken. It works for everyone in this room. There's plenty of people who it doesn't around the world. But I would assume everyone in this room, you can send money, you can get your standing orders, you can pay your mortgage without any problems in TradFi. But I guarantee you there's 1,000 little ways that it sucks. Be that when you're trying to send money overseas and it takes ages and costs you a hard fee. Be it when you're trying to apply for a loan and you only have one or two choices. Be that when you get access to investments that you're excluded from because of your net worth. None of those are make or break. They're not saying that the system's broken today. It's just that all of those things could be better, and the whole of them makes a big difference.
It's actually interesting you said that. When we had a conversation earlier, you mentioned about staking a percentage of your net worth as opposed to... you want to comment on that?
So this is a silly regulatory example I give, which I am in no way qualified to make a good comment on, but it's a simple example that makes sense to me. So if you assume the regulations are in place for consumer protection, the example I like using is accredited investor laws in, say, the United States. Now, they're said that you can't go into certain investment opportunities unless you're an accredited investor, which means you've got to have over, I think, about $1 million net worth or $250,000 a year income. Now, that's set pretty arbitrarily, because is someone with $999,000 financially inept and someone with $1,001,000 suddenly a financial genius? Probably not. Now, in Web3, we have a unique opportunity to create far more precise and forms of regulation. So in the accredited investor law, what about a simple system where you're like, hey, you can put 2.5% hypothetically of your assets into these high-risk investments. Now, suddenly, if you've got $100 million net worth or $1,000 net worth, you can still access that position on on-chain data. Makes that very, very simple to do should you want to. And you both, both of those participants would have the same opportunity and get the same reward for taking the same risks. It won't make it equal. The person with $100 million is going to get a greater total amount of assets back for that same position, but it creates a system that's just a little bit better. It's one of those thousand ways which Web3 makes the system today look archaic.
Do we have any final remarks?
I wanted to answer that question as well. I think it's maybe a bit longer term, but I think as a society, we started with smallish kind of communities, and we went into massive centralization, not only for the financial system, but we all only know the nation state. That's the only supreme entity that everyone knows nowadays. And I think we all live to some extent into that golden age of globalization, and we see that we're going back into something that is going to be less globalized and less mobile. I think that Web3 has the power in the long run if you don't end up with in very bad paths with nation states going with nukes and all of that, to go back to a more humane type of communities where basically people can just interact communities with other communities, not just through Bored Apes and other kind of NFTs, but actually in the way that people live, in a way that is more manageable, because then that decentralization and that infrastructure becomes feasible. The nation states arose because of technology, because communication became better, become legibility became better with writing, with research, with all of that. And NFT has, and Web3 has the power to bring us back to a situation where basically we have smaller and more closely knitted type of communities.
Makes sense, yeah, absolutely. Any final remarks from any of our panelists?
I think it's maybe like calling it out as it is, but the greatest crypto is like one of the greatest use cases is still like global financial markets 24/7. Markets shut down at certain hours every day. It's 24/7. It's the greatest casino on earth. I don't think we can deny that. It still is, and it's going to continue to remain the case. And hopefully, we evolve beyond this use case, right? Beyond just speculation. That's the hope for the future.
Well,
I was going to say something similar, but almost sort of the opposite, which is that because I'm not from a traditional finance background, I do see Web3 as more than only crypto, that they shouldn't be confused as being exactly the same thing, and that there'll be lots of people in this room that maybe don't have a financial background or that crypto isn't maybe as relevant in their own lives, but might be thinking about how might Web3 impact my business or my own career or even my family's wealth, but doesn't have to be crypto necessarily. So it's kind of, I guess my point would be, go and seek out what those opportunities are for yourself or your business, and sort of be constantly curious and sort of keep reading about Web3 because it is evolving, I was gonna say by the day, but it is like by the second, what you're saying about sort of all that casino vibe. So go and learn stuff.
That's a valid point. That goes back to the positioning, isn't it, of Web3 versus the cryptocurrency, but the whole ecosystem itself. Well, thank you very much. Thanks a lot.